Welcome everybody at my session. Great to see so many people. Welcome. My name is Michiel Overheem. I'm a lead software architect at AFAS. And in this session, I am going to talk about event sourcing and more interestingly, how you can evolve your event store after launch. So how are you handling evolution of your event store? So a quick introduction of the company that I work for, AFAS Software, based in Leusden. 400 plus employees, you can read it yourself. More interestingly, we build software. We have a single product, AFAS Profit, which is an ERP system. Now, as you can imagine, it's a large domain. We have HRM, CRM, finance, order management, and so on, everything to automate your business. And currently, I'm part of the team that is rebuilding the system, and we're using event sourcing for that. And that's one of the reasons that we investigated event stores and how to evolve event stores. Next to working at AFAS, I'm also a PhD candidate in the research project Amuse. That's a research project that we are doing together with University Utrecht and the Free University of Amsterdam. And that's also the reason why we approached this topic a little bit more theoretical and broader than AFAS would do on its own. Because we wanted to share it with the research community. So event sourcing. How many people know event sourcing? Know what it is? Great. How many people are doing it? Okay, and how many of them are in production? Okay. A few. Okay, so let me give a quick introduction for those who aren't familiar with it. Event sourcing is a data model. It's an alternative data model next to current state, what we traditionally are doing in systems. So for instance, if you look at a bank account, you could say in a current state model, I have an account ID, a balance, and I have an owner. And in an event sourced world, you can see that we have events, of course, bank account created. Well, what happens when we change this bank account, the balance? For instance, I do a deposit. You can see in a current state model that we change the balance. But in an event sourced model, we append the new event. So we are keeping track of our history. And when we do a withdrawal, again, you can see in the current state that we only adjust the balance. But in an event sourced model, we append to the log. And finally, when I change the owner, you can see it reflected in the current state and the event sourced model. So in the current state, you can see that we aren't aware of the changes happening in the past. So sure, but this is normal for bank accounts. Like, we all see our history of transactions, so nobody would model a bank account with a current state model. But we can also apply this, for instance, for your shopping cart. Left again the current state, and this time we have a shopping cart. And when we add articles to the shopping cart, you can see in the current state that we only are aware of what's in the shopping cart, but on the right side we have all the events. And now when I remove something from the cart, and we add something back, you can see the difference. So normally, or traditionally, in a current state model, you would only know what the current state of your shopping cart is. Well, in the event-sourced world, we know what the history is of the shopping cart, and we can do, of course, interesting things with it. So it might be obvious, but of course, the current state can be derived from the event store. So it's not that we aren't possible to, it isn't possible to create that current state model, but we can derive it from the event store. So why do people use this? Well, one of the obvious things, of course, is why was something changed in the history, in the past? So for instance, in the shopping cart, you can see the history, so you know what has changed, but you can apply this in all kinds of domains. So part of the research is that we interviewed a lot of people doing event sourcing. And one of the systems was an email templating system for marketing departments, and they were it was possible to track the changes on email templates. So they could say to the marketing department, you changed the template at this point, he has done it, so don't blame us. Well, that's one of the reasons why people do event sourcing. Another one is multiple data models. So more often you see systems that have full-text search capabilities, analytics on graphs, maybe document databases. So we see multiple data models being used in the same application. And with event sourcing, it becomes possible to have a single source of truth, the event store, and derive all the other databases from that event store. And one clear advantage is that you are able to do things in the future that you aren't aware of that you want right now. So if you look back at the shopping cart example, you might start a web shop and you build your system and you are just building the basic features and you aren't aware of that in the future you want to do, for instance, analysis on which articles are removed from the shopping cart and which items are added back afterwards. So if you would do that with the current state model, you can never do that analysis in the future. You have to change your data model, and from that point on, you can do the analysis. Well, if you start with an event source model, you can go back in time and do the analysis. So this is something about planning for the future. So to sum up, we had the audit log, flexibility in data models. We don't want to throw away information. Temporal complexity. So for instance, if you have a system where for loans or other finance systems, it's important to track the temporal aspect of your domain. Event sourcing is a great data model. Some people use it as a message bus replacement because you have the event store to read from instead of Azure Service Bus or RabbitMQ. And finally, debugging. So for instance, when a customer finds a bug, you can go back in the event store, replay all events, and you can do the analysis of the bug, and you can show what you can see what happened, and you can fix it in your code, and just replay the events. So this is some of the reasons why people do event sourcing. But now, of course, the real topic of this talk, there is a dark side to event sourcing, and that is upgrading, evolving your application. And the reason why we started this research, this investigation, was because in the community there wasn't really much knowledge about this. Most people just said, your event source is immutable, you shouldn't touch it, go on with it. Well, that's only part of the solution, because there are many other solutions that are possible. You just have to know what your context is, what your requirements are, and what you are then able to do. So this was for us the reason to start this investigation. So how can we handle changes, and what's the best way for our context? And one of the reasons for us was that because we have such a large system, and we have a large data model, keeping all events and versioning looked problematic, because that would grow enormously our source code base with all versions of events. So we wanted to see if there were other possibilities, and we found them. Okay, so let's go back a little bit and first look at the structure and the schema of stuff before we are going into the solutions. So the event store is nothing more than a stream of events. Like I showed earlier, it's just append only of events. And a stream is an ordered list of events. So the ordering is important, because when you use an event store, you know that the order that you appended is guaranteed and is consistent. And that also shows a problem if you have a large system or a distributed system, because then ordering becomes a problem. So that's why most of the time an event store is not a single stream, but multiple streams. I'm going to keep this a little bit abstract, because I'm not showing what kind of streams, because that depends on the domain. So you could, for instance, split up on instances of stuff or types of events or whatever you want. It's not really important for the solution, but it's good to remember that per stream we have an ordering. Over the streams, there's no ordering. There's no guarantees if you combine those streams that you know the ordering of stuff, because they could be originated from different machines and have different clocks and so on. And an event is nothing more than a name plus attributes and their values. So I've shown a JSON example, but of course it could be XML or protobuf, whatever. Just to give you an idea what events are. Well, that's the structure of an event store. But there is also a schema. Which streams are known in the system? Which events are allowed in which streams? Which events can occur? And which attributes are allowed in which events? And this is very important, because this is the schema of your data model of your event store. But in event sourcing, this schema is implicit, and it's hidden in the code. And that makes evolution harder because you have to be aware of that your schema is in your code and you have to track those changes to not hit bugs at runtime. So to give you an example of a schema, let's go back to the web shop. And let's say we have two streams in this case. We have shopping cart stream and customer streams. So all shopping carts events go in one stream and all customer events go in the other stream. And we know what type of events can occur in which stream. So this is an example of what an implicit schema might look like. And now, of course, we want to know what kind of operations can change this schema. What are the types of changes that can happen, because that determines what the solutions could be. So for instance, we can add an attribute to an event. Could be a schema change. Say we add newsletter functionality and users can opt in at sign up. So we add an attribute. So the solution of how you're going to implement this is completely separate from the schema change. So it could be that we say, from now on, the customer signed up event has this new attribute. We could also do it with a new event in the stream, separated, not changing the customer signed up event, but introduce a new event, opt-in on newsletter. We might introduce a new stream, for instance, managing the newsletters. So these are very basic changes. We can all imagine adding new stuff and how to deal with that. But of course, we can also have more complex operations. Say, for instance, we started with a full name attribute, which wasn't very smart, and we need to split it to first name and surname so that we can sort our customers and do nicer stuff with the information that we have. Could also be that in the future we need to split events. Say we started out with adding an attribute to the event, and after a while we thought, well, that wasn't really a good idea. Let's change it to the new event, and now we have to split events. And finally, it could be in the future that we decide that we want to split a stream. So I explained earlier on that within a stream, all the events are ordered. So it could be that a stream becomes very large and you need to distribute it. And then you might want to split out streams so that you can handle this distribution. Well, and then you have to do this kind of splitting, which is, as you can imagine, harder to do. So these are some of the operations that can occur. And as we look at the structure of an event store and the operations, we can see that we have operations on the event level. So that are all around attributes, adding, removing, splitting, merging. We have operations at the stream level. And we have operations at the store level. And as you can imagine, the very top level is the hardest one. Because if we say streams are independent and they can be distributed, then doing stuff over streams is hard. Well, on the lower levels, they might be easier. Not saying that they are easy, but easier. So this is what I already mentioned, executing operations crossing stream boundaries. So before we dive into operations and techniques to handle those operations, it's good to look back at the immutability in the audit, because this is one of the selling points of event sourcing and event stores, that things are immutable and that it's an audit log. Well, we have to be honest, this is a choice. This is not the only reason to do event sourcing, and you can do event sourcing without it being immutable and audit. Of course, you can get other problems, but it is a choice to what level do you want immutability and audit. I've talked to many people doing event sourcing, all kinds of different systems, and there are only a few that really treat it as immutable, with hashing and all kinds of checks that the events aren't changed. Because most of the people just assume it's immutable, for instance, or even say, well, we can change this and this and this, but we conceptually think about it as immutable. So there is a whole kind of gray area on what kind of level of immutability you're after. And one of the other things in the techniques of executing your operations is that you need to be aware of your clients. So I already showed that event sourcing can help if you want multiple data models or if you want to derive your current state. So let's assume that you have a client that builds up some kind of dashboard over your event source. And your client walks over your stream, creates a dashboard, and of course, at the end, your dashboard is fully consistent with your event store, and when new events arrive, your dashboard will be updated. But what happens if you now change your event store? There are a couple of problems. Are you going to replay? Could be a possibility, but if you have millions of events, that might be a problem. Can you keep your derived data model in sync with your changes in your event store? Might be very complex. So that's something to be aware of as we look at the techniques that we can use, how you are going to deal with your clients. It's also important to know if the client is controlled by you or if it's an external client, depending on some kind of API, because that might even be harder to update. So how can we execute the operations that we saw? Well, the first option is one that's been told to many people on, for instance, the DDD and CQRS message board. Just always extend. Introduce new versions of your events, keep the older ones, and you have to support them for eternity. So for instance, with the newsletter approach, we just create a new event, customer signed up version 2. We extend our client to handle this new event. And we now have two events actually meaning the same, but we have a version 1 and a version 2. That can be a possibility. But your code base would only grow. And how complex will your code be? So depending on your system, it might be a perfect solution. But as for us, managing an ERP system and the rate of changes that we expect, we thought it would be very problematic to support all events for eternity. Another technique is that you can move from a schema that is constraining, telling you what is allowed, to a schema that's more forgiving, telling you what can occur. So by doing that, you tell your clients, you can assume there is an ID, for instance, that your identifier, that will always be there. All other attributes are optional, so you have to deal that they are not being there, or that new attributes are added, or stuff like that. So we call that weak schema and weak serialization, because it's also important in your serialization that you can handle missing attributes or attributes that you weren't aware of being there. And this can be a problem if your serialization is from, for instance, JSON of XML to fixed classes in C Sharp. That can give you some headaches. And again, it might end up with an explosion of if-else paths in your code, because you have to check every attribute, decide on what to do depending on the attributes. Important one, also with the previous technique, is can we handle all operations by doing this? I don't think so, because we aren't able to split events or merge events, because these operations are all on the attribute level. Can we handle new or deleted attributes? So we move on to another technique, and this is one that's also very known in the NoSQL world, because there you have kind of the same problem. With a document database, there is no fixed schema on writing, but there is an implicit schema. Your application kind of assumes a certain structure in your documents. And when you update, it might be very hard to go over a million of documents in MongoDB, for instance. And this is a technique that's also been applied in the NoSQL world, where you, between the client that reads your event store and your event store, you put a layer in between. We call that an upcaster. And that upcaster is responsible for transforming your events in schema version 1 to a schema version 2. And of course, you can have multiple upcasters. So if you keep on evolving your application, you can put them after each other. And by doing this, you get a whole layer of evolution at runtime. But this comes with an overhead, because now at runtime, every event needs to be transformed by the upcasters. And still, can we execute all operations? Well, we can split events, because when we read in one event, we can give two events to the client, of course. We can merge events. we just keep hold of the one event until the next comes in, we merge them and give them to the client as one event. But merging events or streams from different sources might be much harder, because that means that you need to read two streams from different databases and merge them and do some stuff with them. So if we look at the upcaster, there is another possibility. We can create an upcaster that not only transforms the events, but also writes back the upcasting result. This means that on the next read, you don't have to do the upcasting. So that is a possibility, but you don't know when you're done. So you have to support the upcaster forever, or you have to read your events to look at what the status is of your upcasting. And this can be problematic from a performance point of view, because you're now mixing an event-only data model, your event store, with updates. And that kind of conflicts if you look at it from a performance point of view. So in all our interviews and research, we have found no one doing this. So if you are doing this, I'm very curious. But it's a possibility. Okay, then in-place transformation. So now we are moving from the runtime solutions, so the event-only, the weak serialization, the upcaster, those are all runtime solutions. You have to implement them in your application code, you don't change your event store, you just apply them when reading them. And an in-place transformation means that you are just looking up the events that needs to be changed and change them. So this is one of those techniques where you have to be aware that you have clients that have read to a certain point, and now they have to go back or have to be updated in some form. So we've labeled this as being very, very dangerous, because you're now changing your event store, and you have not really a mechanism to see if that change really reflects the changes that you need to make, if it reflects your schema changes. So this is very easy to make mistakes. If you look at the current state data model, where we just updated a database, it's kind of the same thing. And it can be really dangerous to just overwrite information or change your data model and throw away stuff that you really needed to keep. But we've talked to people who are doing this, for instance, to fix bugs in production. So finally, one of the last technique that we found is the copy and transform. And what this entails is that you write an updater that reads your event store and just writes a new event store with all the changes that you need. So you just walk over your event store and write out new events as you read them in and do the changes that you need to do. Well, this technique is the most complete one, because you can do all changes that you need to do. You can combine streams, you can split streams, and so on. You will automatically have a backup, because you're just reading your old store, so you have whatever you had. But this, of course, could be very slow. And again, you need to update all your clients. They either have to read your new event store and produce new data models, or they have to be kept in sync some other way. So, from a research perspective, we need to compare these approaches and we have to create some tables to make it more scientific. So that's what we've done. So we had a couple of things that we wanted to compare on, and we put them next to each other. So for instance, functional suitability, meaning can we apply all operations using this technique? Well, if you look at the multiple versions, the weak schema, no, we cannot, because, well, in the multiple versions, yeah, of course. We can just create new streams, new events. You might be able to do every operation, but I'm wondering if you are willing to do that, creating stream version 2 or event version 2 for as long as you need to support your application. Weak schema, you cannot do anything, everything. You can do some things, but not everything, because event boundaries and stream boundaries are problematic. Upcasters can be useful to do all operations, but depending on your situation in distribution, you might not be willing to do every operation. If that means that an upcaster needs to read a whole stream before it can output new events, that might become a serious runtime overhead that you're not willing to take. That's why we marked it as average. The lazy transformation is the same because it's basically an upcaster writing back whatever result he has. And the in-place transformation and copy and transformation can do everything because they're just external applications updating your event store. So you can do whatever you need to do in those applications. Well, if you look at it from a maintainability perspective, the multiple versions is hard to keep maintainable because you're just adding new paths to your code, new versions, and you have to maintain all that code. Weak schema is somewhat better because you're now not having all those versions, but of course you have all these different paths in your application. For upcasters, you only add new code because every change in the schema is a new upcaster, and that's again code that you need to maintain. The same holds for lazy transformation. The in-place transformation and copy and transformation can be easier to maintain because they're one-off changes. You write your updating application once, run it, and then you can throw it away because you have a new event store. If you look at it from a performance efficiency, then the multiple versions, the weak schema, and the upcasters are better because you're doing it at runtime, so there is not really in your updating of the application, you don't have to write a new database or change your database. You can just deploy your new application and your upgrade's done because all data model upgrades are done at runtime. Of course, lazy transformation and in-place transformation are a little bit less efficient because they have to write the database, and copy and transformation is the less efficient because you have just writing everything again. Finally, reliability. So the runtime approaches are very reliable because if you make a mistake, you just update your application again and your changes again are applied at runtime. The lazy transformation and in-place transformation are less reliable because you have to do the backup in yourself. You are changing in place, so you have to make sure that you have a backup. Otherwise, you can really screw up your event store. And copy and transformation creates an automatic backup. So that's pretty reliable as long as you keep the backup, of course. So the main outcome, which is pretty easy for such a research, is that it depends. But for us, this was really important because there was some kind of sense in the community that there was only one solution. And that was all at runtime. You never should change your event store. Well, we found out that there are pretty much 50% of companies that we talk to that are just changing their event store and they're doing perfectly fine with it. They're still running and they're making money with their product, so there's nothing keeping you from doing that. You just have to be aware of what your context is and what your solution can be. So from those interviews, we have a couple of takeaways and context examples that I want to share with you. So first of all, at the beginning, we talked about that event sourcing is a good model because you don't throw away information, so you can do things that you haven't thought about in the future. Well, it's mainly about not throwing information away without a reason. Because if you have a reason, you can just throw away stuff. There's no reason to keep all your events for eternity. So for instance, we talked with people doing streaming video on an event source base. And every position in the video, if one paused, was an event so that they could track off their position in the video. Well, if you have 4 pause minutes in a video, the first 3 aren't that important, so you can just throw away them and you can make a roll-up event of the latest position. So that's one of the examples in context where it's perfectly fine to throw away events. You just have to have a good reason. Another aspect is that time can be of a great help. So, for instance, the example of a finance system doing transactions might be perfectly fine to create an event at the end of the day that will be the starting event for your next day and just ship the old day did yesterday to some offsite location and not keeping it. Maybe for analysis, but not in your live system. Or, for instance, take eBay. If a listing is removed or is finished, you can ship it away to maybe some analysis cluster, but you don't have to keep it in your live system, making evolution far easier because you don't have to deal with all your history at that point. Another that's important is we talked about replaying, and you hear a lot of people that you don't want to depend on replay, because that's problematic if you want to replay. Millions of events and replaying takes maybe 2 days. Well, that can be a problem if you depend on it in your upgrade situation, because now you're going from an upgrade in 5 minutes to a 2-day upgrade, and nobody wants to do that. But there are lots of event source systems that are small enough to replay in half an hour, maybe in an hour, and then it's a perfectly fine situation to do a copy and transform replay, and you're up and running again. So it's also really important to look at your situation and how fast the replay can be. Maybe the application is small enough to do this. Another one that we found is that you can replay to a new database. So for instance, if you have the dashboarding application and you decide to change the event store, you make a copy of it, you can just create a new database for your dashboarding next to the old one, and when it's finished, switch the button to show the new dashboard. And by doing that, you can buy yourself some time, so the customers will see the upgrade in a later time, but you're still able to do the replay. And that's also a perfectly fine solution. So one of the things that I haven't talked about yet, and well, this is kind of the community where event sourcing, of course, originated from, the domain-driven design community. So two things. Event sourcing isn't tied to domain-driven design. You can do event sourcing, don't do domain-driven design, but just use it as a data model. It's perfectly fine. Again, I've talked to people doing that, and they're happy and running. But I've also talked to people doing domain-driven design in event sourcing, and they told me it was a great help, because domain-driven design helps you to sketch your domain, know what you're talking about, for instance, event storming, to find out which events are happening in your domain, and that really helps to lower the amount of evolution that you need to do, which of course makes it all that easier. If you don't have evolution, you don't have these problems. You can just keep on running. So that's something to look at if you're doing event sourcing but haven't looked at domain-driven design. I would suggest to do that. So finally, of course, this was all research, talking to other people. What have we done? So we started out by implementing the copy and transform, because we wanted the most functional, complete solution. And we thought about, well, if we do copy and transform, we are sure that we can do any operation that we need to do in the future. We also do the replaying in the background. So we have a blue-green deployment in which we copy and transform the event store to the new deployment and replay everything. And when it's done, we can switch the button. So that's our basic, our most fundamental solution, because we can handle every operation. But we're also planning on doing a hybrid form. And if you look back to the slides, you can see that some techniques had preference on doing it runtime and being faster. And what we're looking at is making a combination of upcasters and a copy and transform, doing some operations through an upcaster, and at some point in time we can then remove the upcasters and do a full copy and transform, which helps in maintainability, but gives us a kind of a balance between the two. And that's something that more people have done, doing upcasters, and whenever they hit four upcasters on one type of event, they will do a copy and transform and remove all the upcasters to keep the performance overhead minimal. Okay, so this is basically what we have found out until now. This is a short overview. If you want to read more, there's of course the paper that we wrote, The Dark Side of Event Sourcing. But might be not that fun to read, because it's for the scientific community. There's another one. It's a book of Greg Young. He's writing versioning in Event Store, and it's more from his experience writing about all kinds of patterns doing the versioning. So that's also highly recommended. And with that, I want to close and thank you all for coming. If there are any questions, I'm happy to answer them, of course. Thank you.